Celeste is one of the most mechanically and emotionally challenging games I have ever played. In today's episode, we're going to be taking a look at the game design techniques used to subtly trick the player for their own benefit and its strange effects on the story the developers are trying to tell. So spoiler warning from this point onwards, guys, and welcome to the anatomy of Celeste. Our story follows Madeline. After ignoring a warning from a haggard old lady, she then decides to scale Mount Celeste. We then follow her journey up this mountain, helping other budding explorers or troubled locals overcome their problems while also attempting to confront the ghosts of her troubled past. So, for anyone who doesn't already know, Celeste is a puzzle platformer, and because puzzle platformers have a greater emphasis on precise movement to solve these puzzles, it's extra important that the controls feel extra tight. And Celeste has some of the tightest and smoothest game feel design I have ever seen. But not in the way that you would think. We spoke about game feel in terms of character design and control in The Anatomy of Hollow Man. Looking at the specifics of the knight's controls and how small changes can completely change how a character feels to play. But I want to talk about something a little bit different in today's episode. Something that is completely invisible to the player. Designed leniency. So games aren't black and white, rarely being what they appear to be. There are a lot of invisible mechanics designed to aid or trick the player working in the background. For example, the player expects the designs of enemies, movement mechanics, or level designs to stay consistent throughout the game, but they are subtly being tweaked and manipulated to aid in providing a smoother or more thrilling gameplay experience. And in Celeste, the two that have the biggest impact on gameplay is the leniency in its hazards and controls. First off, hazards. Celeste's levels are covered in a horde of hazards, from simple spikes or a miasma of emotion juice. Madeline will just simply pop out of existence if she touches these hazards, so it's important that they feel fair. This death is actually caused when Madeline's sprite collides with the hitbox of these spikes, and it turns out if this hitbox matches the spikes exactly, it just feels wrong. The player feels like they hadn't actually touched these spikes yet and something might be wrong. So the developers have shrunk this hitbox to begin about halfway down its visible sprite, adding this leniency in how much leeway you have to actually be killed. This is also true of the edges of these spikes. They've been shrunk down to allow for the player to walk off of ledges, climb or wall jump close to hazards, allowing for these incredibly near misses, which just feel amazing. This kind of leniency can also be seen in how Madeline controls herself. One of the main methods of movement is Madeline's dash, and when using it, there is this tiny delay before it is actually executed, and this could be seen as a negative, maybe some kind of input lag, but it is actually designed to allow the player to have a few frames to change their mind about which direction they would like to dash, allowing for greater control over Madeline during precise platforming situations. And these kinds of invisible designs exist in nearly every game you have ever played, and take experiences that would be considered grueling if they were designed precisely, and add leniency to make them feel fair. And this is needed in Celeste, as it throws a litany of challenges at you, from extra collectible strawberries, heart puzzles, and cassettes of redesigned levels that can be incredibly challenging. Plus, each new area you visit introduces its own unique mechanics. This could be intimidating for newer players, but Celeste gets around this with its perfected environmental progression. Madeline's journey up Mount Celeste takes her to some unique places, from winding windswept tunnels, the contorted corridors of abandoned hotels, to the heart of the mountain itself, and each area she ventures through introduces its own unique mechanics. And introducing this many new ways to play could be too much for some newer players, but Extremely OK Games, got around this by making all new mechanics they introduce environmental. What I mean by this is, apart from this one moment in the game's climactic level, no new mechanics are ever given to the player, they are just expanded on. Mechanics themselves can either be personal, where the player is given a new ability to execute themselves, or environmental, where the mechanics is based in the environment itself and expands on an ability the player already has. For example, Ori and the Will of the Wisps is a wonderfully designed game, but one that overcomplicates its control system by giving the player way too many personal abilities that eventually become overwhelming to keep track of. But Celeste keeps its mechanics as an extension of these three core abilities: jump, dash, and grab. Each new way to play that is introduced requires the player to use, say, the momentum of objects, precise timing, or puzzle solving to progress through each level. They're always adding new ways to play to keep the player engaged, but never giving them any more controls to think about. And this allows them to develop mechanical mastery much quicker. We introduced mechanical mastery in the Anatomy of Hollow Knight episode. Play the clip, Edinger, mate.
Well, mechanical mastery is the state where once the mechanics of the game become settled into your muscle memory, everything just melts away, and you just do. You don't need to think about pressing the buttons during gameplay, it just happens. And this is sometimes called reaching flow state or being in the zone.
Yeah, we get it. Having fewer controls to consider can induce a flow state much faster, and this allows for a smoother and more satisfying experience for the player overall. And because of this, these controls are clean. But there is another side to this that is unique to Celeste. It's how this environmental progression affects the game's story. For the entire game, we've been following Madeline's journey up the mountain and her struggles in navigating its twisting caverns, but also navigating her own self-doubt and anxiety. This is then manifested in this darker alter self of Madeline. She is literally being chased by her problems. I know it's subtle, but as she progresses, instead of trying to repress and run away from these feelings, Madeline comes to terms with them and accepts them. And this is the first and final moment that the player gains a whole new ability. It's the ability to triple jump. And it's connected with Madeline coming to terms with her own mental health struggles. This is a genius way to take the positive design of environmental progression and then giving an ability to the player, accentuating its narrative importance, allowing for the player to empathize with Madeline and feel the same joy and sense of relief through gameplay. And I think it's amazing how this game can help me and so many others come to terms with these emotions and struggles that so many of us actually struggle with on a daily basis. Do you know what I'm saying? Another great thing about having so few buttons to worry about is that they can be mapped to the controller in multiple ways. And yes, adding multiple buttons that do the same thing is completely redundant, but this also allows for you to play exactly how you want and also makes the controls more accessible. And this is by far Celeste's greatest strength, its attention to accessibility. When you first start Celeste, you are given the option to use an assist mode. This allows players to do things such as slow the game speed, gain infinite stamina, or become completely invincible. And you'd think with a game as intentionally difficult as Celeste, why would the developers ever destroy that difficulty with options like this? Well, it all comes down to making the game accessible to as many people as possible. It's very easy to get trapped in our own minds and our own personal experiences when playing games, and not factor in others and their unique experiences. I have friends who, due to certain disabilities, are unable to play or even access certain games. For example of this, please go and watch this documentary on Toby Ock. It's called Gaming Through New Eyes, and I hope if you do have a negative opinion on difficulty settings or accessibility options in games, that this documentary might open your eyes to why this is so important. Toby is completely blind, but uses music and sound design to navigate games such as Final Fantasy and fighting games that have features that make these games accessible for him. His play experience is very different to yours or mine, but it is his experience. He is only able to play certain games due to most games not factoring in sound cues into their accessibility options. It is our duty as designers to try and make our games as accessible as possible so people like Toby or anyone with unique experiences can access our games and enjoy them in any way that they can. Extremely OK Games should be commended for adding this assist mode to their game. But on the other side of it, all games should be doing this. These things are difficult to develop, don't get me wrong, especially when trying to cover the array of conditions people might be dealing with, and trying to develop for every single specific disability is inconceivable. But mod support in games allows others to create these specific tools so more and more people can access this wonderful hobby that we all share. And at the end of the day, isn't that what we all want? More people to share with. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I really hope you enjoyed today's episode. And I just want to say a big thank you to Escapist and my wonderful patrons for actually making this possible. And if you too do enjoy this series and you want to see more, I actually have my own channel with lots of similar content over there. And I can't wait to see you over there as well as on here on the Escapist. Thank you so much for the support, mate. I'll see you in the next one.